So our next speaker is Caroline Le Penec, who is a doctoral candidate in the economics department and one of the organizers of TextXD 2018. She's going to be talking about electoral campaign messages in French legislative elections, historically, right, over time.
Okay, so I'm going to present a joint project with Paul Vertier, who is an economist in Paris. And so this is a project about electoral competition and campaign messages. So the broad, the research question we are going to look at is the extent to which politicians respond to changes in electoral competition. In particular, we are going to explore whether candidates adjust their campaign messages when the set of competitors that they are facing changes over the course of the campaign. So more specifically, we are going to exploit a unique setting in which we can observe a large number of two-round election races and in which all the individual candidates that compete in these two-round elections have to issue a campaign manifesto before each election round. So we assemble a new data set of more than 30,000 manifestos that are issued by these candidates in over 9 legislative elections. And the text analysis methodology, where the text analysis kicks in, is that we are projecting these manifestos onto a left to right axis using various scaling methods. And we use the partisan score that we get from that scaling to measure the within candidate changes in their discourse between the two election rounds. So in this rather short talk, I will describe to you the institutional setting and the data that we use. Then I will talk about the method we, how we scale the manifestos. And then I will show you some evidence about how the discourse changes between the two rounds, and I will conclude. So first, institutional setting and data. So this unique setting that I mentioned is the French legislative elections. So they are held every 5 years to elect about 500 representatives, and so one representative per district. And the electoral rule is a uninominal majoritarian rule with a runoff. So what it means is that there is a first round where multiple candidates run. It's on average 9 or 10 candidates, depending on the year. So from the entire ideological spectrum, from far left to far right. And if none of these candidates gets an absolute majority of votes, then a runoff election is held 1 week later. And between only eligible candidates, which most of the time it's only two candidates, sometimes it can be three or four. And then after this runoff election, the final winner is the one who gets the most votes. So before each of these election rounds, candidates can, and in practice they all do it, issue a 2 pages manifesto, which is part of their official campaign spending, and which is mailed to every registered voter. And as anecdotal evidence, there was a survey before the last legislative election that suggested that voters actually care about these manifestos and read them. So they were seated among the three most common ways that voters learned about the candidates in their districts. And that was after television and online news, and before radio and newspaper. So those are not negligible campaign advertisements. So what we do is we use a corpus of these manifestos that was collected and digitized by a research center in Paris for all elections between 1958 and 1993. So that's a historical data set. It's not very recent, but it covers a very long time period. So unfortunately, I'm not sure I'm going to be, So example of what the manifesto looks like. So that's the manifesto from Jacques Chirac, who later became president. But in 1988, he was running for Congress, legislature. And so as you can see, it's a 2 pages document. Usually it has a picture of the candidate and is what would be the replacement in case something happens to him. And then the content can vary a lot. Candidates are completely free to write whatever they want. But of course, the purpose of the manifesto is for them to introduce themselves to the voters and talk about their motivations and what they would do if they get elected. So these manifestos were almost all collected and digitized, as I mentioned, and they are for this period. and they are publicly available on archive.org in already in machine readable format already, which is really great. One big obstacle that we face in collecting this data is that the digitization was done at the district level, which means that when you download the document, it's the collection of manifestos for all candidates in the district, not one document per candidate. So the computer doesn't know who wrote which page. So it was we tried to automate this kind of like identification of the author. It was never like accurate enough, so we ended up doing it by hand with the help of like many undergraduate research assistants. But so now we have a full sample of more than 30,000 manifestos over these 9 elections, and there is a little bit of attrition, but not so much. So we can cover 87% of all the candidates who ran over that period. Okay, so now what do we do with them? So first, we do some pre-processing to reduce a bit the vocabulary. So we remove the stop words and the special characters. We lemmatize using the spacey French model, which is not perfect, but which seems to be kind of like the best out there. And we exclude the words that are used in less than 0.5% of the manifestos or more than 50% of the manifestos. So we basically remove all the words that are not too infrequent or too frequent. So we end up with an average vocabulary of about like a little bit less than 5,000 words per election, because we are going to treat each election separately. So we adopt a bag of words representation, where each manifesto is just a vector of word frequencies, and the corpus is represented as a document term matrix. And the objective for us is to reduce the dimensionality of this huge document term matrix and project the manifestos onto some latent unidimensional scale that would be more that we can deal with more easily to compare candidates and to compare their positions between the two rounds. So to do that, we first do some completely unsupervised principal component analysis to validate that a simple left to right scale is indeed relevant. So I don't have that much time, so I won't show it to you guys, but you can believe me that indeed it works, or like I can show you later if anybody's interested. And once we validate this intuitive left to right scale, we are going to explicitly scale the candidates on this left to right dimension. And to do that, we first do something very easy that's adapted from a method called WordScore. And then we do something way more fancy. And I will show you that they both yield strikingly similar results. OK, so first, the easy thing. So it's an adaptation of a WordScore's method that was developed by a political scientist in 2003. And so one thing that is important to remember is that we scale manifestos for each election separately. So we don't pull the vocabulary across the period. We really treat each election independently. So in this method, the partisan score of a document is just the average word score of the word it contains. And to construct these word scores, we first, so we take all the manifestos from the first round for a given election. And we, because we know the party affiliation of all candidates, we can aggregate all the manifestos from the candidates that are from a well-identified left-wing or far left-wing party. Same thing for the right. And then we construct the word score as being some index of the relative frequency with which the word is used by a left-wing versus a right-wing candidate. So intuitively, a word that has a score of -1 is a score that is only used by left-wing candidates and never by a right-wing one. And inversely, so and a word that has a score of 0 is a word that can be indifferently used by each side. Then we do some additional normalization, and that's just for like interpretability. So when you see a document with a score of -1, that would correspond to what I call a typical manifesto of a left-wing candidate, and a score of 1 corresponds to the typical manifesto of a right-wing candidate. So to show you that like this method works pretty well, I will first show you the words that the most left-wing and the most right-wing words. So because I score each election separately, here I take the average word score over the 9 elections. So those are words that are consistently more on the left and consistently more on the right over the period. So you can see that on the left, we have like words like Communist Party, Capitalist, Employers, Disarmament, because that was during the Cold War, and like the left was really pushing for stopping all nuclear weapons tests and stuff. Redwood Worker, Unionist, Activist, etc. On the right, we have like words that are closer, that are so ideology, leader, recovery, patriot, liberalism, and the European meaning of liberalism. So it actually makes sense, et cetera, et cetera. So we see, just looking at the world, we are capturing something that makes sense, at least some left-right division that makes sense. Another way to look at it, and well, the colors are kind of like look kind of the same from here. But here I plot the density of the estimated partisan score, still at first round, pulling all years together, so it's a standardized score, for candidates from the far left and candidates from the left. So here, like, I know the colors are not great, but the density that has more mass on the left is the far left. So this is something that's not mechanical. So what's slightly mechanical is that indeed those two densities have more mass on the negative side, because they were when we constructed the worst scores, they were like on the negative side. What's not mechanical is that the far left has more mass on the left than the left side. So here, like, the simple method, like, is able to pick up that, like, far left wing candidates are indeed have a more extreme discourse than the left wing ones. Then if I add the center guys, which were not even included when we calculated the worst score, we see that they are indeed closer to the center. And then that's the right and the far right. So a simple method like does a pretty good job as capturing the dispersion that we would expect given the party affiliations. But there are some concerns. So one is that there is this method is kind of ad hoc, like it's not grounded into any theoretical model of speech. And the more, maybe a bigger concern is that it may suffer from bias because of infrequent words. So intuitively, like even if I purge the vocabulary a lot already, if some noisy words happen to be used by left-wing candidates and never by right-wing ones, but even if they have no political meaning, they would still get like a very high score, and like that would just like add a lot of noise to our measure. So one concern is that what we observe is mostly noise. So to make sure that it's not the case, I do some robustness tests, I change the vocabulary size, I change the size of the scale. But more importantly, I use this other method, multinomial inverse regression. So for those who were at the training yesterday, that's going to look familiar. So it's a framework that was developed by Matt Taddy like a few years ago. So in this model, speech is derived from a discrete choice over words. So you can think of the frequency of each word as being an independent row from a multinomial distribution, so that the probability of seeing word W in document J is this multinomial logistic function over here, which depends on this variable DJ, which is the non-party affiliation. So here it's a variable that's equal to 1 if J is right-wing and -1 if J is left-wing. And so the parameters of interest are these phi W's, which are word loadings, which measure the sensitivity of word W to party affiliation. So that's intuitively, that's the lift in utility from using word W as candidate J is becoming more right-wing. So once we get these phi W's, we can construct this Z projection, which is just the average word loading in document J. And that has been shown to be a sufficient reduction for partisanship. So intuitively, the ZJ is going to be a one-dimension summary of my very long array of word frequencies that's enough to capture partisanship, to represent the text on this party affiliation dimension. So that's going to be our alternative score, partisan score. So then there are some tricks about how to estimate this model. The important one is this gamma lasso penalization, which shrinks the noisy loadings to zero, so which reduces the influence of these noisy words that might just be driving the results. So we do all of this, we get our projection ZJ, and we plot them against our initial easy partisan score for each election separately. And as you can see, it's pretty much a straight line. Showing that like the two methods are giving us exactly the same thing. And that's true for all elections. So here, this is a prime example where like the easy thing is doing just as well as the fancy one, basically. So I'm gonna keep working with the easy one for the rest of the talk. So everything that I showed you until now like was about the first round, so now let's include the second round. So I used the word scores constructed from the first round to score the manifesto of the second round to make sure they are all on the same scale, using the same vocabulary. And so this is the density of score at first round across all parties and across all years. This has superposed the density of still the first round, but for the candidates who will make it to the runoff. So that's showing the selection effect, the fact that the candidates who go to the runoff are already kind of like closer to the more moderate in their discourse. And now I superpose their score at the second round, where we see that it's completely shrinking and getting closer to the middle, right? So this is a moderation effect where like we clearly see that candidates like change their discourse in a way to become more neutral, to get closer to a neutral partisan score. So in the next and last 5 minutes, I will quickly talk about additional tests that I do to try to understand how text changes, like why and along which dimensions are they becoming more neutral. So I first look at the words that are dropped or added the most across the rounds. Then I look at kind of like which moral values they talk about. And here I build on work by Jonathan Haidt and other psychologists. And I adapt something that Benenke, who is an economist, recently did to compare the relative frequency of communal moral values versus universal ones. And finally, I count the number of times that they talk about a local place around their district. And so first, the words that are dropped the most and added the most. So the words that are added the most are not super informative because they are very generic words that are, so you can see like second, next, victory, confirm, second again. So those are just words that are added because it's the second round and they are like some kind of like institutional words. But I think what's interesting is that on the side of the words that are dropped the most, you see that they're almost all of them about policy issues. So like firm, creation, economy, family, safety, manufacturing, entrepreneur, activity, taxation. So it seems like politicians are talking a lot less about actual platform elements and a lot less about policy issues. So they're just, instead of just changing their position on different issues, they just stop talking about them. And then for the other measures, so like what we call each coefficient represents the change in those different measures. So the first one shows that, first of all, the second round manifestos are much shorter in terms of number of words. They talk, so like I control for that in every regression that I make from the lens of the manifestos. The share of words that are moral related to moral values is also smaller, which makes sense because if they stop talking about policies, they probably also stop talking about ideological things that are ideologically charged. This communal index goes up, which means that they refer relatively more often to moral values that are kind of like in-group values, as opposed to universal ones. And they also talk more, they also mention more often like local places in the area. So as a conclusion, we found that the candidates who make it to the runoff become less partisan. They adopt like a more moderate discourse. They tend to drop ideological content, either like moral values or policy issues. And they refer more often to communal values and to local places. So our interpretation so far is that they strategically choose to signal a more consensual position in the second round because now they have to appeal to a wider range of voters, not just their electoral base, which was caring about their electoral platform in the first round. And they do so by referring more often to kind of like local in-group issues. So like appealing, addressing the voters as a local community of voters, as opposed to emphasizing the policies that they actually care about.
Time for 5 minutes for questions because okay. One of our speakers dropped out, so we have a little more slack in the schedule right now.
Anybody has a question? Yeah.
When you have you mapped the communal values versus universal values on that left to right scale?
No, I haven't done that yet. Actually, that's a good point. I should do that.
Yes. Question. So when you exclude rare terms prior to any adjustments to the sensitivity to rare terms, so a 0.5% and then 50% for frequent ones. Is that, could you talk a little bit more about the parameter tuning?
Oh, why I chose those numbers? So the upper bound, so the 50%, really doesn't matter whether I cut out these words or not, it doesn't change anything. So yeah, like, but for like the 0.5%, like it does, it is important, like it does change this thing, like whether I exclude the two where words or not. And so I chose 0.5 because it's something that it's I don't know, but it seems to be a convention, like there are like other like papers in this is political science that choose that threshold. So I kind of followed them. I tried, of course, like to make sure it was my results were robust to alternative thresholds, and it doesn't seem to change that much. Yeah.
Is the worry that it would overtrain on extremely unique terms that might have nothing to do with the
Yeah. Exactly, and there's also like, so as I mentioned, the text, the documents are already available in like machine readable format, so they were OCR'd by this research center like in Paris. But the OCR is okay, but it's not great. So like, I also have a lot of just like, you know, like spelling mistakes or like that are due to just the fact that like the not so great quality of the thing. So like, getting rid of all these infrequent words already like cleans a lot of this and removes like all the those like badly written words. So that's also why it's important to do it.
Misspellings.
Yeah. Are there geographic differences, like proximity to Paris versus?
So I tried to look into that, and there was no clear. So I guess I didn't have like a good intuition for even like what I was looking for and like what type of like what heterogeneity I was expecting to see geographically. So I haven't looked into that in detail, but I guess it's because I don't really have like a good question in mind about like what am I trying to look at if I look at the.
And this only goes to 1993.
Yes.
And so I'm thinking about in 1958, the beginning of the common market. And just these things are getting off the ground, that it may be that in urban areas, especially in the Foncière of Paris, that people are talking more about sort of this sort of and in more rural areas or smaller cities, that they are talking more about things about France or about their region in France.
That's true. Yeah, I could
so
really
the
do
content,
that.
Not just the partisanship, but the content may be related to the partisanship.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah. Yeah, so I wouldn't need that.
And that would change the kind of also because the European economy and the European Union and the euro, the single currency, it starts to get off the ground. And I think that's if they're working through all of this. Right? So that's a possibility that those larger scale political issues could be reflected in the differences in the geographic differences in discourse based on all the policymakers who have.
Yes.
So central class.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So it seems to me that there are two forces that might be at play here. One is what you're describing, the moderating effect, but there may also be instances when candidates want to differentiate themselves mm-hmm. from the other candidates. Have you thought about thinking about the candidate's choice as a function of who else is going to be in?
Yes. So yeah, I tried to look into that. Unfortunately, like I couldn't get any like clean results, so like no significant differences. Basically, depending on, I tried that. So like, what happens when I'm facing a candidate that is more right wing than me versus a more left wing than me? And there are differences, but they're not clear and they are usually not significant. And I think a reason is that these measures that you construct from text are like inherently like quite noisy. So when it's about identifying big changes in discourse, it works. If it's about just like subtle differences in the language, then it might not be able to pick it up. So that's why I haven't put any of that in the presentation because I don't have really clear like nice results on that, unfortunately. Wait, we have to stop.
We have to stop.
Okay.
Sorry.
Well, I'm happy to talk about it later.
So you can at lunchtime ask Caroline.